While the emphasis is religious, Easter has become so heavily commercialized these days that the start of spring sparks supermarkets to load the aisles with Easter cards, Easter bunnies, Easter eggs, Easter bonnets, Easter foods, and spring daffodils. But for many devout Christians, the real focus of Easter is on Jesus' resurrection and their belief that he died on the cross so that their own sins could be forgiven.
Why do people celebrate Easter? When did the celebration of Easter first begin? Do people know the true meaning of Easter and its significance to Christianity? What is the truth?
When you think about Easter and you think about the Bible, you're not really thinking about a cyclical event. You're thinking about one huge event.
Easter is the most important time of the year for Christians. In preparation for this day, many Christians around the world observe some or all of the special days associated with it. Beginning with Shrove Tuesday, also known as Fat Tuesday or Mardi Gras, Ash Wednesday, followed by the 40-day period of abstinence or fasting known as Lent.
Easter as a big public festival, we're talking about looking at its origins going back to the 4th century, but it's what it celebrates as a faith goes right back to the start of Christianity, if you see what I mean.
This period concludes with Holy Week, Palm Sunday and Holy Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Triduum, Holy Thursday, Good Friday and Saturday, with the last day being Easter Sunday.
Easter season starts with Shrovetide, which is on a Tuesday. In England, it's known as Pancake Day, but in other parts of the world, it's known as Mardi Gras and Fat Tuesday.
My parents were Catholic, so that means we would have been brought up in the Catholic tradition. So that means leading up to Easter, we would have had participated in the celebration of Lent. So we would be always guided by our parents that Lent is coming and you should think of something to give up. And I remember that with my brothers and sisters, even though some of us were very young, and this went through my whole progression of growing up as a young teen during the Catholic Church. But I think essentially, we would all sit down together and try to figure out what we want to give up.
Shrove Tuesday is the first Tuesday before Ash Wednesday and the last day for celebrating and feasting before the 40-day Lenten period of fasting. It takes its name from the word shrive, or to confess. On Shrove Tuesday, Christians confess their sins and ask God for forgiveness. As Lent is a time of abstinence, of giving up one's favorite things, many see Shrove Tuesday as a last chance to indulge and to use up the foods that are not allowed in Lent. In England, the tradition of eating pancakes originated because this was the best way to consume as much milk, fats and eggs. In France, this day came to be known as Fat Tuesday or Mardi Gras because it was a day of consumption of all fats and fatty foods.
Shrove comes from an old word which means confessing your sins, to be shriven. And that's where the Shrove comes from. But on that Tuesday, there was a special thing where, because they were going to be fasting, they ate up all the food there was in the house. So they would have had a big feast before the Lent started, and they got rid of lots of food in the house, because it would have been wasted otherwise.
Ironically, for many people around the world, Shrove Tuesday has evolved into a day of extravagant indulgence. But for devout worshippers, the focus remains on confession of one's sins, repentance and prayer. But overall, there are no instructions in the Bible or from Jesus to observe this day.
Ash Wednesday marks the beginning of the 40-day Lenten season. Is there any scriptural basis for Ash Wednesday?
Ash Wednesday is the day after Shrove Tuesday, which marks the beginning of the Lenten season, when special services are held in churches. In this service, the priest marks an ash sign of a cross on each worshipper's forehead. This symbol indicates that the person is remorseful of his sins. It is also a reminder to them that we all come from ashes, and to ashes we all will return. The marking on the forehead with ash marks the person's commitment to Jesus Christ and God, and is a symbol of repentance for the wrong things Christians think they have done in the past year.
The ashes are made from palms from the previous year's Palm Sunday, which had been burnt, and the ashes are come from that.
Jonah went to the city of Nineveh to preach God to them and said that the people of Nineveh were wicked and they needed to repent. Well, the people of Nineveh, as they say in that book in the Bible, that they fasted in sackcloth and ashes, that they put on sackcloth and sprinkled ashes on their head. And so for us, Ash Wednesday, that's the first day of Lent. And so we call it Ash Wednesday. And then we just put a little, it's not very dramatic, just very simple, little mark of ashes, some ashes put on the head. But some different countries actually sprinkle ashes on their head.
Some have linked this holy day to sorrowful repentance by sprinkling oneself with ashes, as mentioned in the Old Testament. And Tamar put ashes on her head and rent her garment of diverse colors that was on her, and laid her hand on her head, and went on crying. 2 Samuel 13:19. For word came unto the king of Nineveh, and he arose from his throne, and he laid his robe from him, and covered him with sackcloth, and sat in ashes. Jonah 3:6. However, these references cannot be used to justify the practice of creating a new day called Ash Wednesday. These verses of the Old Testament clearly mention how early Christians grieved sorrowfully by covering themselves in ashes, or by wearing handmade garments of sackcloth covered in ashes, not by having a little holy ash cross marked on their forehead by a priest or minister.
The 40 days of Lent are a period of abstinence and penance. But was this something which Prophet Jesus taught?
It reminds us of our own death. It reminds us that time is short. It reminds us that things in our lives will never stay the same for long, and we have to think about ourselves. So Lent is a time, as I say, for penitence, but also thinking about your faith.
What we call Lent, it's a period of fasting or of prayer in preparation for Easter. Now we use the number 40, but it's never exactly 40 because of the way the weeks work out, but it's 40 plus. And we calculate that, once we calculate Easter Sunday, we count back approximately 6 weeks, so that we will have 40 weekdays.
According to the Encyclopedia of the Early Church, Lent is mentioned for the first time in 334 by Athanasius. Originally, people did not observe Lent for more than a week. Some kept it for 1 or 2 days. Others kept it for 40 consecutive hours in the false belief that only 40 hours had elapsed between Jesus' death and his resurrection, according to Christian doctrine. Eventually, Lent became a 40-day period of fasting or abstaining from certain foods. There are no references to Lent in the Old or New Testaments, nor any references of Jews or Christians observing an annual fasting period of 40 days before the Passover. Those who practice Lent justify its observation by linking the repentance and fasting of 40 days with references relating to the number 40. And the rain was upon the earth 40 days and 40 nights, Genesis 7:12. And he was there with the Lord 40 days and 40 nights. He did neither eat bread nor drink water, and he wrote upon the tables the words of the covenant, the Ten Commandments, Exodus 34:28. According to the New Testament, Jesus never observed Lent and fasting, neither did he command or teach his apostles to do so. However, Christians believe that the duration of Lent can be identified with Jesus' time spent in the wilderness. During Lent, Christians commemorate the time when Jesus retired to the desert to fast and pray, before beginning his work for God. It also is a remembrance of when Jesus was tempted by Satan, but was able to successfully resist and remain steadfast, and thus succeeded in the eyes of God. The Roman Church developed a high mass for celebrating the resurrection of Christ, but attached to it much of the paganism of the spring festival. Included in this process was the 40-day season of fasting known as Lent, adopted by Rome during the 6th century. It corresponds to a 40-day fast practiced by ancient Egyptians. others identify Lent with a practice among Babylonian worshippers of Semiramis. The death and resurrection of Tammuz was celebrated by a great annual festival preceded by the Lenten fast. The question arises that if the Roman Church was aware that the observation of Lent was not an inherent part of the biblical teaching, nor of Jesus' practice, then why did they constitute a pagan holiday?
Right back to the start, people have questioned the faith, particularly, but more so when Christianity became more common, people started to question the faith, as is known today, and started to give alternative theories. But no, the official teaching is death and resurrection.
Many hold the view that the Christian Church amalgamated the festivals in the hope of subtly integrating Christianity into the nation at large. Its origin is the pre-festival fast, which was also observed at this time of year by those being initiated into the Christian community.
Holy Week marks the last few days before the crucifixion of Prophet Jesus. The crucifixion is an event which Muslims also believe took place. For Muslims and Christians alike, this is a time to reflect upon the true mission and message of Jesus, a chosen one of God and a devout follower of the Torah. But in order to understand Jesus and follow his pious example, we need to discover the true account of his life. So let us examine what happened in the days before and after the crucifixion, also known as the Holy Week.
It begins with Passion Sunday, and how we start, it's the Sunday before Easter Sunday, it's 1 week before Easter Sunday. So on that day we actually listen to the Passion, which means the suffering of Christ, and we listen to that story of him going into Jerusalem, of being crucified, dying and burying, and we leave it at that. So that begins our Holy Week or our Passion Week and focuses for Easter Sunday. It's also called Palm Sunday because part of the story is that Christ enters into Jerusalem and the people of Jerusalem are so happy to see him that they go out and throw palms at his feet like he's a king. They treat him like a king or like a prophet.
Holy Week is the final week of Lent before Easter. It commemorates the events immediately preceding the crucifixion and the last week of Jesus' life. This is the most solemn period during the church year. Christians devoutly observe this week, commemorating the Passion and Jesus' death on the cross. Holy Week observances began in Jerusalem in the earliest days of the church, when devout Christians traveled to Jerusalem to reenact events of the week prior to Jesus' crucifixion. The earliest days of the church were during the first centuries after the time of Jesus, when Paul constituted the church and it was being formed. Over the centuries, the fathers, then the popes, took over. Later, the denominations crept in with their own views, but the main body is the Catholic Church. The Holy Week marks the final days of Jesus before Easter Sunday. It consists of Palm Sunday, Holy Monday, Holy Tuesday, Holy Wednesday, Maundy Thursday, Good Friday, and Holy Saturday. The final 3 days are part of the Easter or Paschal Triduum. Holy Week originated during the 2nd century.
The week before Easter, it starts off with Palm Sunday, which is the Sunday before Easter Sunday. Jesus makes a triumphant entry into Jerusalem. He's acclaimed by the crowds. They're all out waving palm branches, cheering him as the Son of David, and it's a wonderful, there's a sense of joy. And then straight away, in the middle of the Palm Sunday liturgy at Mass, it changes to an anticipation of the Passion. And then all of that week you're getting readings. The Old Testament readings are about the suffering servant, in which is prophesied in the prophet Isaiah, and he has these songs anticipating this mysterious servant of God that was going to suffer. And you hear these readings, you see the plots building up against Jesus, and then suddenly on Good Friday, it's there in front of your eyes, everything that the prophet has said.
These are days when the church reflects on the last days of Jesus' earthly life. These days are commemorated through various church services, where hymns and scriptures are recited, following the same cycle of events recorded in the story as told by the evangelists. In the home, Christians are meant to spend more time focusing on prayer during this period. Most families also use this time for spring cleaning. It is said that cleaning the house during these days is similar to the Jewish tradition of cleaning before the Pesach. Good Friday. The celebration of Good Friday is, according to some historians, a custom which originated in the 4th century. Over the centuries, the day gradually became the time of penance and fasting. At the anniversary of the crucifixion, and according to Christians, the death of Christ. Many churches hold quiet services from noon until 3, called Treor, or 3 hours. This service focuses on the words Jesus uttered as he hung on the cross, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, which means, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Good Friday is a somber time in the Catholic Church. Thus there are no flowers, and the altar, the chancel, statues, pictures, and the cross are all draped in black to represent mourning. However, once again, there are no biblical teachings that direct Christians to celebrate Good Friday. Not all Christians do so, with some churches refraining from communion until Resurrection Sunday. Holy Saturday. This is the last day of the Triduum in the Holy Week, and the 40-day Lenten fast, which commemorates Jesus lying in the tomb. Holy Saturday is a day to be observed as quietly as possible. This day is also known as the Day of the Entombed Christ, when Christians reflect on the passion, suffering, and death of Jesus, and how he was finally laid to rest in his tomb. No services are held on this day. The worshippers spend the day quietly reflecting, and this leads them to the Easter Vigil.
Easter Vigil is known as the mother of all vigils. On this night, Christians remember the great pain and suffering inflicted upon Jesus, and they also mourn his death.
The Easter Vigil. On this night, Christians all over the world will gather in the darkness representing their somber reflections of the day. The reason why this vigil takes place during the night is because it is believed to coincide with Jesus' resurrection, which also occurred during the night. During this night, worshippers silently pray and focus on the hours when they believe Jesus slowly came back to life. They also celebrate his profound sacrifice for their sins. The Easter Vigil rites begin with the lighting of a new flame or fire, which represents Jesus' return from the darkness of death, bringing with him the new light of hope and salvation through his resurrection.
On Easter Sunday, many Christians rise before dawn, face towards the rising sun, and rejoice the resurrection of Jesus. Was this practice taught in the gospel, or is it in direct contravention of biblical teachings?
Easter Day, sunrise service. While this custom is not practiced by all Christians, some will participate in the Easter sunrise service. When worshippers rise before dawn on Easter Day and go to an elevated place or to the side of a church and face towards the rising sun. After the sun rises, the worshippers sing an Easter hymn praising the resurrection of Jesus whilst holding spring flowers. They close this service by holding hands and praying together and then proceed to prepare for church services. The Old Testament mentions a similar practice in Ezekiel 8, 1-18, where Ezekiel saw that the people of Israel were facing towards the east when the sun rose and worshipping the sun. This was strictly forbidden as it constituted sun worship. But this is exactly what worshippers do in the Easter sunrise service. If Jesus did not instruct this kind of worship, then where did it come from? On Easter Day, Christians celebrate and rejoice Jesus' sacrifice of his life to free mankind from sin. It is widely believed amongst the Christian world that Jesus was a sacrificial lamb offered at the Passover, as mentioned in Exodus 12:13-14.
It's not a holiday that's enshrined in the Bible, certainly not like, say, the Eucharist, where you can look back and say that Jesus said, "Do this in memory of me," therefore you can build a theology around the Eucharist. You really can't. I think it's something that Christians have decided to commemorate as a way of teaching themselves on a yearly basis their theology.
From the biblical accounts of the New Testament, it is determined that Jesus was put on the cross when he was observing the feast of the Passover. But Jesus did not predict or indicate that this would happen. So where does the concept of Jesus atoning for the sins of mankind as the paschal or sacrificial lamb originate? It emerged from the Christians celebrating the death of Jesus with a paschal meal, Eucharist, on the lunar date of the Jewish Passover. "Purge out therefore the old leaven, that ye may be a new lump, as ye are unleavened. For even Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us. Therefore let us keep the feast, not with old leaven, neither with the leaven of malice and wickedness, but with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth." Corinthians 5:7-8. These verses prove that it was Paul's teaching to replace the Old Testament Passover. His New Testament concept of the Passover allowed Christ to supersede the Paschal Lamb. Despite Paul's claims to love and honor Jesus, he did not hesitate to replace the Old Testament Passover, which Jesus and his disciples followed, with his new concept.
Easter is an Anglo-Saxon word, obviously only in English, and it comes from an Anglo-Saxon goddess who was Eostre, who was the goddess of the spring, because Easter in our part of the world happens at spring. And so they took the old pagan name and stuck it on it because the pagans would then think it, they could convert.
The word Easter represents the festival observed by many Christian churches in honor of the resurrection of the Savior. Easter is a word used in Germanic languages to denote the festival of the vernal equinox. The word Easter is not found anywhere in the Old or New Testament, except for one reference in the King James Bible. "And when he had apprehended him, he put him in prison, and delivered him to four quaternions of soldiers to keep him, intending after Easter to bring him forth to the people." Acts 12:4. After examining biblical evidence, one may assume that the festival of Easter may have been observed during the time of the apostles. According to the New Bible Dictionary, the original word in the above translation has no reference to that, nor is there any evidence that any such festival was observed at the time when this book was written. The original word should have been Passover, Pascha, not Easter.
So what are the origins of Easter customs such as hot cross buns, Easter eggs, and Easter bunnies? Could it be that Easter has pagan origins? Then how and why did Easter become associated with Jesus and the Bible?
As the observation of Easter is not instructed in the Bible, then where did Easter originate? Scholars agree that the name Easter has its root in paganism. It is never used in original scriptures, and its exact origin remains uncertain. According to Bede, it is connected with an Anglo-Saxon spring goddess. The time, the customs, and the traditions of Easter all come from ancient pagan, non-Christian religious celebrations. Thus, Easter was originally a pagan festival in honor of the goddess of spring. The word Easter is supposed to be derived from Eostre or Istra. Eostre was the deity of both the dawn and spring, and the pagan symbol of fertility. At her festival in April, sacred fires were lighted on the hills, especially in the Nordic lands. During the same season, the ancient Romans observed the feast of the vernal equinox. Over the centuries, Easter celebrations have also supplemented many more customs, mainly incorporated from springtime fertility celebrations. Hot cross buns stemmed from the pagan festival which had the Saxon fertility goddess sacrifice an ox. Thus the horns in the form of a cross became a symbol of the season, carved into breads. The cross represented the moon, the heavenly body associated with the goddess and its four quarters.
Fundamental thing for me was, as I became older, I think it was around 13 or 14, I started to question the whole concept of even Easter. What was its significance? What really did it entail?
First off, I think for Christianity, we have built an awful lot around the cross, true suffering, something that even Mahatma Gandhi latched onto in his campaigns, this idea of suffering for the truth. That has to do with the cross, that has to do with the idea that even the Messiah had to suffer. And even though he was the Messiah, it would appear to us that it cost him his life.
Whenever Christianity came to a country, the people were pagans. And instead of throwing everything out, they took on some of the rituals that they were doing, because it made sense to people.
As Christianity spread throughout Europe, buns were made in the traditional method, but the cross now symbolized a crucifix of Jesus. The Easter bunny and eggs both represent fertility. Dyed eggs were also used as part of the rituals of the Babylonian religions. None of these pagan traditions have any relevance to biblical teachings. Moreover, in accordance with the Old Testament, such practices should never be adopted. Take heed to thyself that thou be not snared by following them, after that they be destroyed from before thee, and that thou inquire not after their gods, saying, how do these nations serve their gods? Even so will I do likewise. Thou shalt not do so unto the Lord thy God, for every abomination to the Lord, which he hateth, have they done unto their gods. For even their sons and their daughters they have burnt in the fire to their gods. What thing soever I command you, observe to do it, thou shalt not add thereto, nor diminish from it. Deuteronomy 12, 30-32.
But what do the earliest sources tell us about the events which occurred between Good Friday and Easter Sunday?
The inaccuracies, contradictions, and inconsistencies in the New Testament cast a great shadow of doubt on its reliability and accuracy. In view of this, the most ardent scholars have attempted to go back to the original early sources, ancient texts of the Bible in the form of codices, fragments, and manuscripts, in the aim to try and trace exactly what happened during the life of Jesus. Such ancient sources have come to light through archaeological findings. Of the decades of excavation, archaeological discoveries have provided evidence and assisted researchers in verifying the reliability of the Old and New Testaments. Some discoveries have shed completely new light on the biblical stories. Amongst the discoveries were the Codex Sinaiticus, which is the oldest surviving Bible in the world. Codex Sinaiticus is also one of the most important witnesses to the Greek text of the Septuagint, the Old Testament in the version that was adopted by early Greek-speaking Christians, and the Christian New Testament. This manuscript of the Christian Bible, written in the middle of the 4th century, has immensely contributed to the reconstruction of the original Christian biblical text in history. When examining early texts, the process of searching for the truth becomes ever more complicated for Christians.
So there's many, many theories. As you mentioned, there are a lot of different communities, and within a lot of communities, there, say, Muslim communities, there are different interpretations of whether or not Jesus appeared to die on the cross or not, whether it was someone else who was substituted there. There are even Christian heresies that suggest the laughing Messiah, someone else went there. We really don't know. We don't know for sure. We have many interpretations, and I'd say in respect to all the scholars, there are many views that we just can't prove, that so much time has gone, there are no eyewitnesses we can interview, and even if there were eyewitnesses we could still interview, they would have a different story. That's why we have four Gospels.
it's a place of mystery that they don't know. It's even a place, it's quite a dark place, that it's a place people don't want to go to. A lot of the ancient Psalms are saying, like, I don't want to die, because the dead cannot praise you. God is only with the living. So it's, you know, it's not really well understood. But we leave it to mystery.
According to St. Mark's Gospel, as contained in the Codex Sinaiticus, they went out and ran away from the tomb, besides themselves with terror. They said nothing to anybody, for they were afraid. There, according to Codex Sinaiticus, the Gospel of Mark comes to an end. It does not so end, of course, in the authorized version of the English Bible, nor in the received texts of any of the Orthodox Christian churches. Their version all continued with a further 12 verses. The scribe who brought Mark's Gospel to an end in Codex Sinaiticus had no doubt that it finished at chapter 16, verse 8. He underlined the text with a fine, artistic squiggle and wrote, "The Gospel according to Mark." Immediately following begins the Gospel of Luke. In Luke 24:51, we are told how Jesus left his disciples following the resurrection. He blessed them, was parted from them, and was carried up into heaven. This last phrase, "and was carried up into heaven," does not appear in Codex Sinaiticus, nor in Codex Vaticanus. According to the textual critic C.S.C. Williams, if this omission is correct, then there is no reference at all to the ascension in the original text of the Gospels. The early century manuscripts, Codex Sinaiticus, Codex Syriacus, Codex Vaticanus, and Codex Bobbiensis, do not contain the last 12 verses of the Gospel of Mark. This is a notable omission. It is these verses only which contain the description of Jesus' resurrection appearance. Since Mark's account seems to be not only the earliest, but also that on which Matthew and Luke base their accounts, a question arises. What is the basis for the accounts of Jesus' bodily resurrection, according to Matthew, Luke, and John? The fact remains that God saved Jesus from dying as a result of the most extreme, shameful form of punishment, that of crucifixion.
Jesus had many bad things done on him. He was scourged and called names and mocked and laughed at, taken away from his friends, totally lost on his own. And he did nothing back. He remained silent at his trial. He didn't fight. He didn't defend himself. He didn't start a revolution, because the disciples wanted to get swords and start a big fight and throw out the Romans and defend him. He wouldn't let anybody do anything. And he was killed. In one sense, you could say he took the evil to himself and took it with him into the grave.
He did not die as a criminal, openly, shamefully, and disgracefully in the eyes of the world, as mentioned in the Bible. "Cursed is every one that hangeth on a tree." Galatians 3:13. Christian belief relies on the historical event of the resurrection. If Jesus was not bodily resurrected, he was not God. He did not redeem mankind, and Christianity would have no standing. "And if Christ be not raised, your faith is vain. You are yet in your sins." Corinthians 15:17.
I know in Islam it says, Shubah Laham, it appeared to them. And it appeared to them that all around, whether they were soldiers who were used to crucifying people or people who were the audience of crucifixions, to the followers of Jesus, that Jesus died, that he was taken off the cross and put into a tomb. And on Sunday, he was not there. So for that was God's intention, for the people who observed this event, that this is what unfolded.
So where do we go from here? If there is no record of the resurrection and the ascension in the earliest and most authentic biblical sources, then what did happen? How can we access the true mission and message of Jesus and the original gospel given to him by Almighty God? How can we discover the truth?
O Jesus, I will cause thee to die a natural death, and will exalt thee to myself, and will clear thee from the charges of those who disbelieve, and will place those who follow thee above those who disbelieve, until the day of resurrection. Then to me shall be your return, and I will judge between you concerning that wherein you differ. Chapter 3, verse 56.